Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to our service of worship here in God's house, or if you are watching online. If you're visiting with us, we give you a special welcome. And we welcome back Nathan to our service this morning.
You're very welcome, Nathan.
And we look forward to what you have to share with us from God's Word. There will be tea and coffee after church in the main hall, and everyone is welcome to stay for that. There will be a short session meeting after the service this morning, and it will be in the church here. The home group, which meets in the church office, will meet tomorrow, Monday the 5th of September, at 2 p.m. The home group that meets with Alan and Wendy will be starting with a social event on Saturday the 10th, that's this coming Saturday, at 2 p.m. in their house. So it's 2 p.m. in their house. Online prayer will be starting this Thursday at 7:30 p.m. and the details are on the screen, or if you would like to speak to Alan afterwards. All articles for inclusion in the next Contact magazine should be sent to me or to the office email address by next Sunday, the 11th of September, at the latest. If anyone is interested in coming to communion classes, please wait behind and speak to Nathan after the service. Next week, Sunday the 11th, our service will be taken by David Fenton. And these are all the announcements this morning. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. Great to be with you again. And let's start off right. We're a family. So let's spend a little bit of time saying hello to one another, maybe giving one another a hug. If you're an introvert, just kind of vaguely wave at someone. Don't make eye contact. But if not, go give someone a hug, say hello. Let's welcome each other as a Christian family does. Let's welcome each other now. So you can get up on your seats and do that. So that's the way we do it in my bed. Well, hopefully you feel very welcome among us this morning. Before we kick off, I'm sure many of you are wondering what is happening with the vacancy. I'm sure you're getting bored of me and maybe some of the others. We are making a lot of progress, and hopefully, really a vacancy is divided into two phases, if you will. And the first phase is where the church is readying itself, looking at its vision, looking ahead. And we've spent really the guts of a year because we wanted to do that right. But then the second phase is where we get leave to call, hopefully. And we're hoping that we're going to get leave to call really in the next couple of months. We have a few little bits and pieces that need to fall into place for that to happen. Before we go to Linkage Commission, which is just a group of people that decide really the next stage of our church life. But then hopefully we'll be able to start the process of looking for a minister. Now, lots of things can happen at that meeting with Linkage Commission, and I just want to be honest with you. So there are really three things that can happen. One is that they tell us yes. Go start the process of looking for a minister. The second thing that can happen is where they encourage Presbytery and myself to look really at linking Whitehead with another congregation. Now, I don't want to scare you with that, but it is always an option. And especially in today's climate where there are very few ministers and lots of churches looking. Now, that obviously is not sessions primary call. We think that we have a vision that is big enough, and with God at the helm, we can do a lot of stuff. But Presbytery might feel led, and Linkage Commission might feel led in a different way, And God will bless that too. But that's the second thing. And then the third thing, which is very unlikely, is that they will basically tell us to go back to the drawing board. But again, that's the third unlikely option. So it's really between the first two. And Session will be presenting to them and really trying to make the case that for Whitehead, we really want another chance to see fruitfulness in this congregation. So that'll be where we're at. As soon as we know which way that is, we will let you know. We're not trying to be secretive. We're just, as soon as we know things, they're passed on. But this is where we're at the moment. I would like just to ask you to pray. Pray hard. I hope you have been praying. I hope you've been praying for your elders because they have been working so hard. They've been praying, they've been searching, they've been growing as well in this. Pray for me and for the Vacancy Commission. Pray for those who will present to Linkage on your behalf. And pray for the person that will one day be the minister again, wherever they are, whatever they're doing right now. So that's really where we're at right now. And if it's not clear, please do ask me. You might be tempted to ask for elders, but chances are they don't know the answer to your question. So I do. So please do ask me if you've any questions about that. But hopefully that's clear. Let's open our service now with prayer. Let's pray to God and just devote this time to Him. Father, we love you. You have given us every good gift. And Lord, we just want to worship you this morning. So Father, as we sing to you, as we praise you, as we just give you our all, Lord, will you be with us? Holy Spirit, come and move among us. We're a small bunch of people, but Lord, with small groups of people, you can do big things. So Holy Spirit, come. Come among us now as your people in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand, let's praise together as we sing our first piece. Brother, sister, family, let's stand and worship.
Christ to you.
us pray to God together. Let us pray. Father, it is an honor to come and to worship you because you are just majestic. You are beyond. You are stronger than anything we could comprehend. You are more graceful, more merciful. With words, you speak stars into existence. You craft the mountains with your hands. With a mere thought, you create water systems and ecosystems and all of it, Lord. You are God. And it's right then that we come and we worship you. Not because you want us to even, but because you are worthy of worship. Because all of our lives are spent with our own crown, our own throne, ourselves. How do I get ahead? How do I do things that make me feel good? How do I do things that promote myself? But instead, Lord, we get this wonderful chance to get rid of that pressure, that burden of always promoting ourselves, and instead just to say, you alone are worthy. You alone are good. You alone are worthy of my praise. And even though I'm messy and broken inside, even though I'm really terrified that someone might see how dark my heart is, you see it. And you say, I love you. You are valuable to me. Not only that, but I will deal with the dark heart. I will deal with the sinful choices. I will deal with the problems that plague and keep you up at night. I will bring forgiveness. Lord, that's the gospel, that our past does not define the future when we believe in what you have done for us. You have died on a cross and put to death our sins. But not only that, but you have conquered death and you rose again. And you say, follow me. And so we follow you, putting to death our past life, where we put on our own crown. And instead, Lord, we promote you and say, you are the King of Kings. And the beautiful thing is that if we followed you through death, we're going to follow you into life. Because not even death could hold your people down. As Christians, we know that the funeral service isn't the end. We know that it's just the beginning of the reality of our lives. We know that one day you're coming back to wipe clean the entire slate. You're coming back to redeem the world. Every bit of corruption, gone. Disease, gone. Sadness, gone. And only happiness and joy left in your kingdom. So that's why we say, thy kingdom come. That's why we pray that your kingdom would come here, just like it's in heaven, but it would come here on earth. So Lord, come today. For those who didn't even think that they wanted to come today, for those who are like, what am I doing here? May you speak really clearly. You've got a message for them today. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's say, sing again, stand as well. No eye has seen.
Thank you.
hopefully you have a Bible with you. We're in Numbers, the book of Numbers today, one of those books that maybe you don't visit very often. It's in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, in the wee hand. And we're in Numbers chapter 13. And Numbers 13, in my opinion, one of the most exciting chapters in the Bible. Because it's the first episode we ever have of a James Bond spy movie. I kid you not. You didn't think that was in Numbers, did you? Well, it is. We have our very first spy thriller. 12 men chosen for a very secret mission. And we're going to see what they get up to. Chapter 13. And we're going to start at the very first verse. The Lord said to Moses, "Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders." So at the Lord's command, Moses sent them out from the desert of Paran. All of them were leaders of the Israelites, and these were their names. Prepare to be impressed. Okay. From the tribe of Reuben, Shemua, son of Zachar. From the tribe of Simeon, Shaphat, son of Hori. From the tribe of Judah, Caleb, son of Jephunneh. From the tribe of Ishkar, Egal, son of Joseph. From the tribe of Ephraim, Hoshea, son of Nun. From the tribe of Benjamin, Palti, son of Raphu. From the tribe of Zebulun, Gadiel, son of Sodi. From the tribe of Manasseh, a tribe of Joseph, Gadi, son of Susi. From the tribe of Dan, Amiel, son of Gamali. From the tribe of Asher, Sether, son of Michael. From the tribe of Naphtali, Nabi, son of Vofsi. From the tribe of Gad, Gel, son of Maki. Oh, come on. Seriously. 3 years of training for that. Right? Okay. Whatever. I'd like to see you do it, right? Okay. So, 12 guys, picked for a mission. And here's how it goes. Verse 16. Tune back in. These are the names of the men Moses sent to explore the land. Moses gave Hoshea, son of Nun, the name Joshua. When Moses sent them to explore Canaan, he said, "Go up through the Negev and on into the hill country. See what the land is like, and whether the people who live there are strong or weak, few or many. What kind of land do they live in? Is it good? Is it bad? What kind of towns do they live in? Are they unwalled or fortified? How is the soil? Is it fertile or poor? Are there trees in it or not? Do your best to bring back some of the fruit in the land." It was the season for the first ripe grapes. So then they went up and explored the land from the desert of Zin as far as Rehob towards Lebo Hamath. They went up through the Negev and came to Hebron, where Ahiman, Sheshai, and Talmai, the descendants of Anak, lived. Hebron had been built 7 years before Zoan in Egypt. When they reached the valley of Eshcol, they cut a branch bearing a single cluster of grapes. Two of them carried it on a pole between them, along with pomegranates and figs. That place was called the Valley of Eshcol because of the clusters of grapes the Israelites cut off there. And at the end of 40 days, they returned from exploring the land. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran. There they reported to them and to the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. They gave Moses this account. "We went into the land to which you sent us." And you're right. It does indeed flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit. "But the people who live there are powerful. The cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites live in the Negev. The Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites live in the hill country. And the Canaanites live near the sea and along the Jordan." Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses, and he said, "We should go up, and we should take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." But the men who had gone up with him said, "We can't attack those people. They're stronger than we are." And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. They said, "The land we explored devours those living in it. All the people we saw there are of great size. We saw the Nephilim," and we don't really have time to get into who they are, but basically think a bunch of Goliaths, okay? "And we saw a bunch of Goliaths there.
the descendants of Anna come from the Nephilim, we seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we looked the same to them. Finishing there, verse 33. So, in a nutshell, what's happened? 12 guys chosen for a mission. Go spy. See what the place is like. Keep hidden, but see what the soil's like. See what the fruit's like. See what the people are like. See what the fortifications, see the army sizes. Can we take this place? What's going to happen? The people come back, and every one of them agree, yeah, there's a lot of good stuff in there. But then comes the split, where 10 of them say, yeah, there's good stuff, but we ain't got a hope in that, right? They're giants, they're evil, it's just not going to work, right? We need to stay right here. Now, bearing in mind where they are is like the worst place to be. They're in the wilderness. And I'm not talking like sandy dunes and lovely oasis. I'm talking like barren, dusty, awful wilderness, okay? That's where they are, okay? So for them to say, no, we're going to stay here, it's a big deal, okay? So just think of how much they could be afraid. But then Caleb and Joshua said, no, we can do it. We can do it. We can go it. Look at what God's done with us so far. We can do it. We can go in. We can beat them. We can take possession of this. With God, anything's possible. The ten then say, well, if we can't get them in a meeting, let's just spread loads of lies. So they spread lies throughout the entire people, saying, you know what? I hear that there are dragons in there. Okay, that's not actually what they said, but they spread loads of lies, right? About what kind of fear factor was in there. It's an awful place. You don't want to go in there, right? Okay? And then we end the chapter. I think that if I had one message for you before the new minister comes in, I could probably find it in chapter 13. Yeah. Because I think that there are several things that we can draw out that I think are directly appropriate for us in Whitehead as a church looking to the future. What's going on here whenever the people come back? Split 10 to 2. They all can see the fruit of what they want to do. They can see that what God has in there. Yeah, it's good. Milk and honey, good fruit, awesome. But they're split on whether it's possible to achieve it. As we look ahead as a church, I think we could all agree, we want the fruit that God has for us. We want this place to be filled, not for numbers' sake, but we want it to be full of people who have encountered the love and hope and life of Jesus. Yeah? Nod at me, please. Yes. Mm-hmm. We want that. We want it to be full of kids and young people, not because it's good to have kids and young people, but because we want a new generation who are encountering the life and hope and love that is found in Jesus Christ. We want it to be full of young families. We want it to be full of middle-aged folk. We want it to be full of our seniors as they give the advice and wisdom that they've accumulated. We want this place to be full, not for numbers, not for finances, but because a church that is full of people who are worshiping Jesus is a church that is experiencing the fruit of this kingdom. So we can agree, just like the Israelites were united. But the problem then is whenever we actually have to step foot into it. Whenever it means not just agreeing to a principle, but actually it means then stepping foot over the line. For us, maybe it's stepping foot outside the door, beyond the pew, beyond the home group, beyond something. And as a vision for the future of Whitehead, if Whitehead is going to thrive for the gospel, it is not going to happen by simply sitting in here and encouraging one another about what the fruit looks like. We've got to go out and we've got to grab it. We've got to go out and we've got to search for it. We've got to be prayerful as we step out. And that sometimes is where the split can happen. 10 to 2. What's happening in this passage? Just let me look at three key ideas that maybe will help us as we move forward in Whitehead is, first of all, when the people reject the chance to go into Israel or into Canaan, as we're going to find in chapter 14, they have forgotten who they are. Who are they? They are the people that escaped slavery. They are the people that walked through the Red Sea. They are the people that have been following a pillar of cloud and fire through the desert. They are people who have seen water come from a rock. They are people who have seen manna and quail, basically bread and meat, fall from the sky to feed them. They are people who have seen plagues and healing. They are people who have seen the multitude of signs that happened in Egypt to the Egyptians. They have seen God do things that are remarkable. And yet, when they look into Canaan and they see what is in there, they've forgotten exactly who they are. My prayer for Whitehead, as you guys move forward, is that you will never forget who you are. You are not just a simple cluster of people who happen to be here. You are disciples of Jesus. You are sons and daughters of the King. What does that mean? It means that the Holy Spirit works in you to bring about majestic and holy things. That is your calling that is placed upon your life. You're not called for a normal existence. And I'm sorry if you thought you were. You're not called to it. Your identity is more. But when you forget about it, when you forget that identity, when you forget what Jesus has done for you on the cross, when you forget the wonders that he has provided for you in your life, when you assume that the blessings in your life are because of your own goodness, or, yeah, well, I earned that, that you forget who you are. You were broken and you were healed by Jesus. You were forgotten and then you were brought into a relationship with God. You were sinful and then you were purified by Jesus. You were an orphan and now you are a son or a daughter. You were broke and penniless and now you have an inheritance that is beyond your wildest dreams in heaven. Normally, if you were pretty happy about that, you might say, amen, hallelujah, that's amazing, Nathan, right? Instead of, oh, yes, Nathan, great point. This is meant to provoke you. Because when you remember who you are, suddenly it transforms everything. But when we forget who we are, suddenly when the vacancy leaders up there talking about vision, or when our home group leaders are talking about what we can do to be missional in the time, it's like, well, I don't know. I don't know about that. I could never do that. There are giants out there, don't you know? Whitehead's full of giants. But when you forget who you are, they just stay giants. But when you remember who you are, suddenly it transforms it. So we want to remember who we are. The second thing is that they forget their purpose. You see, if you go right back to Genesis, whenever the father of Israel is speaking to God, who is the father of Israel? Question time. I do this in Downshire all the time, so I thought I might bring it in. They hate it too. Yes? Abraham, let you can be an elder still, okay? Yes, good. Abraham. Yeah, Abraham's the father of Israel. And Abraham goes through this incredible journey with God. But basically, the promise is that he will have descendants. Why? Because it's nice to have descendants? No. Because it's nice to have family? No. But because his descendants, Jesus, our God promised right back in the very beginning, would be a light to the entire world. Now, we remember that whenever Jesus comes, who is a descendant of all this, what is he described as? What do we sing about him? Jesus is the light of the world. The light of the world. Whenever the bread came down from heaven to the Israelites and sustained them in the desert, what does Jesus say that he is? He is the bread of life. You see, Jesus is fulfilling all of this stuff. But when we forget the purpose, the Israelites did not exist just to simply exist. They weren't just a bunch of people. But the very reason for their existence was to be a light to the world. Your existence is not to hold functions here. It is not even to simply worship here on a Sunday morning. Your existence is not about an organization here. It's not even about your friendships here. All of that stuff's good. It's not about the choir. It's not about the elders. It's not about the praise. It's not about the minister. Your existence here is because you are called beyond anything else to be a light to Whitehead. That is it. That is the overwhelming purpose for this church. And if this church stops becoming that, it will close. Because, and I pray for that, because it has no purpose. But we want this church to be full of its purpose. Jesus calls us right at the end of his earthly life to what? To make disciples. To be a light on the hill. He says, what good is a light if it's all kept under shade? What good are you if all of what good happens is in here? I've met you. I know how lovely you are. I know how crazy you are a little bit too. But I know how lovely you are. It would be so sad if that loveliness was cooped up in here. And Whitehead didn't get to see the hope of Jesus that is in you. And if you're already showing this, which I know some of you are, brilliant. But we want more. We want more. So when we forget our identity, it's hard to see anything other than giants. When we forget our purpose, it's hard to even get beyond ourselves. But finally, they had forgotten God. This was the thing. Because yes, they may have forgotten going through the sea or the pillar of cloud and flame. But who was behind all of that? Was God. When we forget that part of our calling is not to go out empty-handed, but with the power of the Holy Spirit who works in us. You're not called to do anything in your own strength. You couldn't. We'd fail. It would just be miserable. And that's what happens sometimes whenever we try and do things in our own strength. It doesn't work. But the brilliant thing about being part of the family of God, the brilliant thing about our identity and our purpose, is that it is infused with the Holy Spirit who says, I will come and propel you. I will help you shine the light. I will give you the creativity. I will appoint people as leaders in your place. I will push you out the door. I will even give you words to say when you feel like you have no words. I will give you power to do miracles. I will give you power to pray into people's lives. I will give you prophetic words that could only be given by God and his Holy Spirit. But I will speak through you. When we forget God, this isn't anything. But when God is at the heart, when the Holy Spirit is at the heart and the hope of Jesus is on our lips, transforming things can happen. I'm excited and expectant about the future of Whitehead. But my prayer is that you will keep these three things at the heart. You will keep your identity as sons and daughters of the King. You will keep your purpose here. Not for anything other than bringing the good news of Jesus to the people around you. And that can be done in many ways. It's not just simply about standing and preaching or a tract. It is through the smile. It is through the welcome. It is through the love that you show. It is through the sharing. It is through the fellowship. Everything that points towards who Jesus is and his goodness. That is gospel witness. It's not just the preaching on the street or whatever. It is the discipleship following of Jesus. But then finally, is that everything would be empty if the Holy Spirit is not welcome in this place and Jesus is not given his proper place as King of Kings in this place. As we move forward, Maybe you just want to pray those three things: identity, purpose, and that the Holy Spirit would come and come mightily. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, would you give us the courage to be like Caleb and Joshua, who know what you have done for us and therefore desire to see fruitfulness. They want to go up into the land and possess it. We want to go into Whitehead and to see your kingdom come. We want to see people encountering the life and hope and love of Jesus. We want them to see the forgiveness and grace and mercy that is in you. We don't care about anything else, Lord, other than that. We want to get rid of the frills that sometimes we can fall into as a church and instead get back to the basics you have called us to. We don't want to be lukewarm like the church in Revelation, but we want to be hot and on fire for you through your Holy Spirit. Lord, we also want to pray for our world. Lord, we want to remember Pakistan at the moment. Lord, as it just unfolds, Lord, it is hard to get the magnitude of it. We're very aware of things that are going on closer to home, like the war in Ukraine, Lord, but things that are further away feel less urgent. And yet, as you see photos and hear stories, we are aware, Lord, of the tragedy that there is there. We pray for aid agencies as they work in both situations. Lord, we pray for your church in Pakistan as it seeks to be a witness and a light. Lord, we pray for governments that they will send aid. And indeed, as the waters subside and as the rebuilding begins, Lord, that you will provide that infrastructure as well. Lord, in our own country, Lord, we know that a new leader will be chosen in the next hours. We pray for them as they take over in number 10. We pray, Lord, that you would guide them. We pray, Lord, that they would uphold peace and justice. And while some people may laugh when we pray this, we know that you are capable of so much, and so we pray it with all our heart. We pray for our own government. We pray, Lord, that there might be movement, Lord, because we know that this is a winter that is going to be hard on many people, and we need those in leadership over us. We pray for them, Lord. Lord, we just pray that you would be with us as we remember who we are, as we remember our purpose, and as we remember the incredible power and majesty of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing our final hymn, Yet Not I, But Through Christ. Let's stand, let's worship God.
There is no more for heaven not to give.
not us, but Jesus in us. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.